Claims of Identity by Alan Lewis Silva. Podcast 7 of 27. Claims of Identity in Bret Harte's Gabriel Conroy. Chapter 6, The Literary Outsider. The Far West, which was the dominant setting of Bret Harte's stories throughout his career, in Gabriel Conroy allows the outsider to have space enough to transgress conventional social rules while still being chivalrous. This is central to bohemianism. Hart's representations of his characters are also accurate enough to be historical, imagined enough to be fictive. Hart should occupy a greater role in the literary history of California because he is a very old example of a still existing cultural trope of the bohemian. One should note that Hart's arguably bohemian themes, inherently regional, focus on the margins, the boundaries, the limits of conventional social behavior and occupation via impostor and outsider claims of identity, portraying a free and democratically representative slice of American consciousness. Hart was also an innovator. The local color movement of literature, the idea that local representations of different regions would offer a more intimate and credible portrait of a place, was popularized by Hart in a way almost unparalleled by any other local color author such as Kate Chopin, George Washington Cable, or Constance Fenimore Wilson. Local color is still important and underappreciated. Few local color authors have represented the bohemian qualities of San Francisco as poignantly as Bret Harte did. As biographer Henry Child Merwin notes, the themes of the poems and stories that Bret Harte wrote during his 7 years' residence in the East did not deal with the human life of that time and place. They either concerned the past, or they harked back to California, like Gabriel Conroy and the stories published in The Atlantic, 244-245. Patrick D. Morrow explains regarding Hart's last essay of literary criticism, The Rise of the Short Story, that the short story Hart viewed especially as an American genre, adding that other local color writers were his literary converts, but not his imitators, Radical 37. Bret Harte wrote stories for the Golden Era under the pseudonym The Bohemian, Morrow, Literary 27. This early Bohemian period, judged by the excellence of the writings it produced, notably Bohemian Papers, provides an explanation about Hart's exposure to the term. Moreover, the term Bohemian applies to Hart's style of writing in broader ways, such as his usually sympathetic representation of the outsider. Although the definition used by Charles Henry Webb insists that bohemianism is a misnomer for any literary growth on this continent, bohemianism continues to the present day and is thereby a historic component of Californian identity, QTD. Furling Heady 34. Bohemianism is related to a period in which an artistic identity takes shape, including ideas of literary theory. In Gabriel Conroy, the motivations for many claims of identity are construed in the archetypal language of both impostors and outsiders, the results of a person's identity being transformed. The bohemian process of self-transformation Hart knew well because he himself underwent it in California as a young man, Stewart 119. Some of Hart's best literary theory he wrote through an eyewitness perspective of semi-fictional events collected in Bohemian Papers long before he would become famous. As Patrick D. Morrow explains, these Californian essays often began in the comically ironic spirit of his earlier Bohemian Papers, written for the Golden Era, but they quickly developed more analysis and better wit, and dropped the self-conscious joking, Bret 29. This evidence of Hart's stylistic transformation implies that bohemianism may also be an intermediary, transitory misnomer for the literary pretension and apprehension emerging artists may feel. Bohemianism in society has been a continual perspective of life, especially relating to the literary outsider, throughout history. It has archetypal origins. Like bohemianism, Gabriel Conroy draws attention to the social roles of impostors and outsiders in California. Gabriel Conroy is one of many works where Hart shows that he understands identity claims relating to bohemian values such as luck and vagrancy. Bret Harte can also be placed among other writers with bohemian qualities such as Edgar Allan Poe, Charles Baudelaire, Henry Miller, James Joyce, Robinson Jeffers, Ernest Hemingway, Clarice Lispector, Jack Kerouac, Allen Ginsberg, and William S. Burroughs. Each contributed his or her own variations and advancements of literary bohemianism, showing that a bohemian's transitional identity is nevertheless a real occurrence. Bohemianism can also be traced to classical antiquity with examples of Homer, Sappho, Petronius, and Catullus. Bret Harte helped pioneer new literary applications of bohemianism such as the claim of identity. Not only by Bret Harte's early self-identification as the bohemian does this treatise regard him as such. At different times in his life, Harte relied on the financial assistance of benefactors and patrons. While in the United States, Harte accumulated large debts from wealthy friends and acquaintances. As an expatriate in Europe, Harte relied, as in the United States, also on patronage from the upper classes and administrative elites. In England, for example, the Van de Velds, a diplomatic couple, materially helped and encouraged Harte, Scharnhorst, Bret 77. These biographical facts show that Harte was familiar with the bohemian values of luck and vagrancy. Bohemians tend to live off their hosts. Artistic work arising from literary patronage also carries with it a prestige. It reifies the existence of the artist amid the harsh realities of an economic world. It shows artistic work to be of economic worth, whereas this is not always the case. In the same way, the economic system of patronage benefits bohemians. Literary patronage even dates from a time when kings patronized poets to write and embellish their achievements. Yet Harte's bohemian qualities are not excessive in his embellishment of the era of the gold rush, recording a unique setting in global history. Many countries such as Brazil, Australia, and South Africa have had momentous discoveries of gold and diamonds. Yet no writer like Harte has emerged in those countries with variations of a gold rush. Bret Harte's writings as a result are incredibly uncommon. The bohemian attention to fashion as a trait of a distinctive identity is also biographically reminiscent of Bret Harte's perennially loud taste in clothing, Scharnhorst, Bret 40. Bret Harte, the literary outsider, is underappreciated. Gabriel Conroy can certainly be favored over other classic Western narratives. Some local color books it compares to close to its time of publication include Mark Twain's The Adventures of Tom Sawyer, 1875, and Roughing It, 1872. Twain's latter book can scarcely be described as surpassing Harte's novel in terms of organization. Twain includes in it over 100 pages of non-dramatic filler about a voyage to the Sandwich Islands. Roughing It also reads primarily as a piece of travel writing mixed interminably with stories and personal commentary. It attempts to construct a verifiable and authoritative account of the people and locations Samuel Clemens encountered. On the other hand, Harte constructed Gabriel Conroy from a series of important, identity-shaping events that more representatively describe the identity of California. Harte uses principally the story of the Donner Party, 1848, facts of the DeHaro legal suit, and the citizenship laws of 1855 as historical reference points. Harte's novel, versus Twain's book, is a less didactic, far more usefully discussed portrait of the identity of early California. As Gary Scharnhorst describes, when Bret Harte crossed the country to Newport, Rhode Island, a home to the wealthy, Harte characterized this new area, too, in a series of important stories and poems that were also critically rejected, Bret 42. These accounts of Greyport came about as Harte struggled to write on topics other than early life in Anglo-California. It is clear, too, that Harte did, in fact, write some of his greatest works on topics other than California. Nevertheless, Harte's return to the East as a writer of some standing from California was a triumph for an individual who came from a background of a kind of poverty, but with books that were abundant. The Harte family, though poor, was well-read. Harte's father, who was a school teacher, tutor, lecturer, and translator, died when he was 8, Merwin 11, 13. By 16, Harte was financially self-sufficient. Interestingly, Francis Bret Harte, as he was then known, also had an older brother who had served in the U.S. Navy during the Mexican-American War, Merwin 15. This older brother, similarly intelligent and more adventurous than Harte, died prematurely of pneumonia in California in the years following the gold rush. Harte's loss of his father and brother may have in some way affected the large role and sympathetic representation of family in Gabriel Conroy. Harte also satirized fools who try to domesticate a bohemian in his 1872 classic story My Friend the Tramp, which is set in Newport, Rhode Island. Harte may have even considered that he was the tramp in the story when Samuel L. Clemens possibly referred to it when he chastised Harte in 1876 over what he perceived as veiled deprecations about Mrs. Clemens' taste in furniture. Had My Friend the Tramp been written 5 years later, it might have proved a too keen portrait of Clemens' envy of Harte and Harte's friendship with Clemens. As Twain insulted Harte in the final days of their friendship for his bohemian attributes, "You are a loafer and an idler. Where have you lived? Nobody knows. Your own people do not know. But I know. You have lived in the Jersey woods and marshes, and have supported yourself as do the other tramps," quoted Eruption 279. An anxiety of influence existed between Samuel Clemens and his former mentor, Bret Harte, Ducat 4. Samuel Clemens at a number of times throughout his career attempted to distance himself from Harte, often through verbal or written insults. Much of the time, too, this came about by directly castigating Harte as Twain famously does in his memoirs. Twain's biased accounts of Harte should not generally be trusted as reliable, although at times they might be. For example, Twain claims that during the writing of Gabriel Conroy, Harte's indifference concerning contracts and engagements was phenomenal. Precious time wasted along. About once a month Harte would get into desperate straits, then he would dash off enough manuscript to set him temporarily free, Eruption 280. Harte, incidentally, wrote a letter to Samuel L. Clemens on March 1, 1877, accusing Elisha Bliss of the American Publishing Company of falsifying Gabriel Conroy's royalty statements, even implying that Clemens may have been acting in ignorance or collusion. These accusations infuriated Clemens because he was the one that had lobbied Bliss to publish Harte's novel in the first place. As Harte explains in the same letter, a letter which permanently severed their friendship, "No publisher of any of my works, at I day, or time has done as badly as Bliss has," Scharnhorst, Letters 145. Bret Harte was a popular writer and does not merit a marginal literary status. Harte's early career in the 1860s was prolific and profound, and also from 1883 until his death he wrote approximately a book a year, contrary to his erratic spurts of creative growth in the 1870s, achieving on the whole what should be recognized as the unparalleled life journey of one early Anglo-Californian author. Harte heralded also a new Californian identity and uniquely refined American writing style. Samuel Clemens claimed that Harte became a corpse when the establishment of the American literary world located in the proximity of Boston and New York branded him a genius. He seemed to be heir to the laurels of a recently emerging American literary pedigree in the era of Reconstruction, Eruption 267. The supposed contrast between Harte in the 1860s and 1870s was so great that Clemens even compared him to a corpse, explaining it is a pity that we cannot escape from life when we are young. When Bret Harte started East in his newborn glory 36 years ago, with the eyes of the world upon him, he had lived all of his life that was worth living, 267. Twain omits recording that in London where Harte eventually settled, he fared considerably better than in the United States. In Europe, Bret Harte wrote the vast majority of his writings. Harte was also an important commentator on American identity. His lecture tours of 1873 and 1874, just before Gabriel Conroy was written, and just after he arrived in the East Coast from California, also provided him a view to parts of the United States he had never been before. In 1874, Harte presented his critical essay, American Humor, which argues that humor is as much regional as identity. Harte elaborates that although inequality would one day end in the South, Southern humor would for a long time retain traces of inequality stemming from the historical tradition of slavery, Morrow, Literary 105. The minstrel show, a distinctly offensive and original American genre of entertainment popular during the late 19th century, for example, is an example of the tense racial dynamics of American society expressed in humor. Harte's assessment of American humor on this account was even more relevant in the period of Reconstruction that he lived and wrote in. Similarly, Gabriel Conroy is Harte's perspective on an absurdly overstated romanticism of Californian identity, inclusive of a pattern of behavior and events surrounding fortune and fame, which today is still accepted by many native Californians as an accurate representation. In fact, Harte had every expectation that Americans would wholeheartedly accept Gabriel Conroy as a classic regional narrative. German readers later would. Local color, as Patrick D. Morrow explains, arose out of the ashes the Civil War left behind. Pointing to a widespread national longing for reconciliation, questioning of American identity and goals, a retreat to nostalgia, Radical 46. Prior to the publication of his novel in 1876, Harte also toured the country delivering a lecture on the Argonauts of 49, crediting the Spanish mission system and Mormon and non-Mormon pioneers for settling the Far West. He praises their courage and discusses life during the Gold Rush. The Argonauts tour was as close as Harte ever came to directly articulating his impressions of California, authorizing attributes of a definitive identity. In doing so, Harte advanced his own claim to literary pretensions. Although Harte did not write as many critical essays as Edgar Allan Poe or Samuel Clemens, he possessed a sound critical acumen that suggests he understood and planned the allegorical settings and motifs in Gabriel Conroy for thematic reasons. It could be argued that Harte wrote zero stories between 1875 and 1876, but a more accurate number is 56, if one were to include chapters of Gabriel Conroy that were published serially in Scribner's beginning in November, 1875. Importantly, Harte relates to his friend, Frank H. Mason, a feeling of genuine satisfaction for what he thought was a great novel and a great achievement, "My dear Captain. I have done a heap of work in the last year. Think of it, a novel, no slouch, but a 600-page printed page story, and DD good if I say it. And a play of 100 pages, Scharnhorst, letters 120. Yet the serialization of Gabriel Conroy perhaps contributed to the novel's negative criticism of having a puzzling storyline because each segment serialized became an incomplete fragment, at least for some readers. As fate would prove, Gabriel Conroy's critical rejection signaled the onset of the lowest ebbing tide of Harte's critical evaluation. Years before, Bret Harte was the genius of American literature. Even Patrick D. Morrow, an excellent critic on Harte's literary theory, claims Gabriel Conroy has a few good episodes, but the novel is tedious, episodic, confused, and it contains some atrocious writing, Bret 12. With the critical rejection of his novel, Harte became more of a literary outsider. Harte's inimical follow-up to Gabriel Conroy in 1877 was a novella that essentially retold Gabriel Conroy using a storyline that at times is identical. The story of a mine was written, as Susan Coleman explains, in a period of extreme dejection and financial insecurity, 40. The novella replaces the silver mine of Gabriel Conroy with a quicksilver mine in the California desert. The characters robbed of their claim are a band of Mexican Americans. At least one critic, Mayo Williamson Hazeltine, noted the excellence of Harte's follow-up to Gabriel Conroy in chats about books, portions of which appeared in The Sun. In Harte's 1877 novel, a group of Mexicans discover valuable quicksilver, a toxic substitute for a pure silver claim. The story of a mine concludes with its protagonist merging into the cesspool of Washington, D.C., where Harte, biographically speaking, was then engaged in freelance writing for The Sun at $100 for a story, one-tenth of what he had made only a few years beforehand. By 1877 Harte was inescapably in debt, suffering what he would years later record in a letter as that awful, terrible last winter. Harte, Letters 115. The fact that only 3 years previously he earned $1,000 for an episode of Fiddletown demonstrates his decline, making his claim to fame for writing what Patrick D. Morrow argues are parables, a part of universal experience and truth much less glamorous. Scharnhorst, Bret 46, Radical 43. After permanently leaving America for Europe, Gary Scharnhorst explains that Harte would again earn a good sum for his stories after hiring a professional literary agent, A.P. Watt, in 1884, opening 177. In 1878 Harte sailed to Krefeld, Germany, where he worked as a consul in a velvet-producing region, Scharnhorst, Bret 67. Harte then changed locations to Britain where he remained for the remainder of his life. As Mayo Williamson Hazeltine recorded of Harte's European popularity in 1883, Bret Harte has grown with signal rapidity, not only in France and Germany, but in the Latin countries of the South. Reviews or translations of Mr. Harte's tales have appeared in critical journals and magazines printed at Lisbon and Madrid, Hazeltine 287-288. With the book publication of Gabriel Conroy in 1876, assuming that critics and, as Harte describes, every gutter snipe of the press who hates me, were friendlier concerning his literary efforts, and also granting that Gabriel Conroy was not serialized 10 full months before appearing in book form, his only long novel could have been the high point of his literary career, Scharnhorst, Bret 64. It is demonstrated with evidence how critics of Gabriel Conroy were incorrect in their assessments. The novel should be considered a classic for a variety of important reasons, especially when considering the time and place in which it is situated in American history. Its unique mix of subjects and locations span the geographic, ethnic, and professional panorama of early California. Its publication on the centennial further suggests a transitional moment inclusive of the westward American migration. Yet the novel is married, too, with the older Spanish romances of the regions of California and the Far West. The novel, in other words, fills a gap in California's own literary history, and fitting Harte's tolerant philosophical attitudes, he does not sit in judgment upon his characters, he seldom says even a word of praise or blame in regard to them. All that he leaves to the reader, Merwin 178. Works cited. Bakken, Mary McAleer. The American Counterfeit, Authenticity and Identity in American Literature and Culture. Tuscaloosa, U of Alabama p. 2006. Print. Barnett, Linda Diz. Bret Harte, A Reference Guide. Boston, G.K. Hall, 1980. Print. Bean, Walter. California, An Interpretive History. Second Edition. San Francisco, McGraw, 1968. Print. Bettman, Otto L. and Van Wyck Brooks, Editors. Our Literary Heritage, A Pictorial History of the Writer in America. New York, E.P. Dutton, 1956. Print. Bloom, Harold. Anxiety of Influence, A Theory of Poetry. New York, Oxford UP, 1973. Print. Carranco, Linwood. Bret Harte in Union. California Historical Society Quarterly. 45 June 1966. Print. Duckett, Margaret. Mark Twain and Bret Harte. Norman, U of Oklahoma p. 1964. Print. Ellsworth, William W. A Golden Age of Authors. New York, Houghton, 1919. Print. Furling Hetty, Lawrence, and Nancy J. Peters. Literary San Francisco, A Pictorial History from Its Beginnings to the Present Day. San Francisco, City Lights and Harper, 1980. Print. Geer, Joseph, ed. Bret Harte, Bibliography and Biographical Data. New York, Bert Franklin, 1968. Print. Grimmel, Pierre. The Dictionary of Classical Mythology. Translated by A.R. Maxwell Hislop. Oxford, Blackwell, 1996. Print. Hart, Bret. Gabriel Conroy. Hartford, American Publishing, 1876. Print. Bret Harte's Writings, Volume 18. Standard Library Edition. New York, Houghton, 1914. Print. Harte, Jeffrey Bret, ed. The Letters of Bret Harte. New York, Houghton, 1926. Print. Hazeltine, Mayo Williamson. Chats About Books, Poets and Novelists. New York, Scribner's, 1883. Print. Jung, C.G. The Collected Works of C.G. Jung, Volume 9, Part 1. Second edition translated by R.F.C. Hull. Editors William McGuire, et al. Princeton, Princeton UP, 1969. Print. Coleman, Susan. Knave, Fool, and Genius, The Confidence Man as He Appears in 19th Century American Fiction. Chapel Hill, U of North Carolina P, 1973. Print. Lang, A. New Novels. Academy. London. September 2, 1876. Print. Merwin, Henry Childs. The Life of Bret Harte, with Some Account of the California Pioneers. Detroit, Book Tower, 1967. Print. Morrow, Patrick D. Bret Harte. Boise, Caxton Printers, 1972. Print. Radical Vistas, 8 Essays on American Literature. Fremont, Fald P., 1974. Print. Bret Harte, Literary Critic. Bowling Green, Bowling Green State U Popular P., 1979. Print. Notices. New York Tribune. New York. September 15, 1876. Print. O'Brien. Dominic Vincent. Bret Harte, A Survey of the Criticism of His Work, 1863-1968. Ann Arbor, U Microfilms, 1968. Print. Ferries, David, ed. The University of Chicago Spanish Dictionary. 5th edition. New York, Pocket, 2002. Print. Quinn, Arthur Hobson, ed. The Literature of the American People. The Later 19th Century by Clarence Goads. Students Edition. New York, Appleton Century, 1951. Print. Robinson, Cecil. Mexico and the Hispanic Southwest in American Literature. Tucson, U of Arizona P, 1977. Print. Scharnhorst, Gary. Bret Harte. New York, Twain, 1992. Print. Bret Harte, Opening the American Literary West. Norman, U of Oklahoma P, 2000. Print. Ed. The Selected Letters of Bret Harte. Norman, U of Oklahoma P, 1997. Print. Stewart, Jr., George R. Bret Harte, Argonaut and Exile. New York, Houghton, 1931. Print. Tenemier, Andrea. Citizenship Debates in Bret Harte's Gabriel Conroy. Complicating Constructions, Race, Ethnicity, and Hybridity in American Texts. eds. David S. Goldstein and Audrey B. Thacker. Seattle, U of Washington P., 2007. Print. Twain, Mark. The Complete Essays of Mark Twain. Editor Charles Nieder. Garden City, Doubleday, 1963. Print. Mark Twain in Eruption. Bret Harte. Editor Bernard DeVoto. New York, Capricorn, 1968. Print. Weinstein, Arnold. Nobody's Home, Speech, Self, and Place in American Fiction from Hawthorne to DeLillo. New York, Oxford UP, 1993. Print.